Hello all. So now let's discuss the rapid MCQ revision series. Now in this section we will be discussing about endocrine system, and the first topic that is indeed a very important topic for you, that is diabetes mellitus. Okay, so before solving the questions, let's have an overview what is diabetes and what are the drugs and what is the management of diabetes mellitus. Okay, so let's see first what is the overview. What is diabetes? Remember, diabetes is a metabolic syndrome. Metabolic disorder means that in the body there is imbalance between catabolism and anabolism. So the catabolic activity in the body increases. Why? Because there is some defect in a hormone known as insulin, which is an anabolic hormone. So all the stores of the body will catabolize. So their glycogen will break down, known as glycogenolysis, which will lead to hyperglycemia. Excessive proteins will and amino acid will also be converted into, they will break down, they will also contribute to hyperglycemia through gluconeogenesis. Fats will break down, it will lead to lipolysis and ketone formation. Okay, now what is the different types of diabetes? The management lies according to that. There are mainly two types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is absolute insulin deficiency. Why? Because the beta cells which are responsible for production of insulin, they have been destroyed because of autoimmune process. So the drug of choice in type 1 diabetes is mandatory to give is insulin. Okay, but there are only two drugs which are approved in type 1 diabetes. One is pramlintide and second is acarbose. Insulin and pramlintide are given by subcutaneous injection and acarbose is an oral drug. Okay, then we have type 2 diabetes. Remember, in type 2 diabetes the insulin is present in the body, but the cells are not responding to the insulin. This is known as peripheral resistance to insulin. The cause of this diabetes is multifactorial. It is polygenic and it is mainly because of lifestyle of a person. So these people are generally obese with sedentary lifestyle, with eating high calorie diets. So these people, they suffer from diabetes, dyslipidemia and hypertension also. So this combined syndrome of all these, diabetes, dyslipidemia and hypertension, is known as metabolic syndrome. Now what is the treatment of type 2 diabetes? Remember, here the drug of choice is metformin. Apart from lifestyle modification, it's metformin, because metformin reduces insulin resistance. If it is still not controlled by metformin, we start with second line oral hypoglycemic agent. And if it is still not seen, not controlled, the last resort here is also insulin. Okay, insulin is preferred in late stage of diabetes and in thin individuals. Then lastly, we have gestational diabetes mellitus, that is diabetes in pregnancy. Remember, drug of choice is insulin, but two drugs are approved for diabetes in pregnancy. One is metformin and second is gliburide. Okay, so this is the treatment of diabetes. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about now the first drug, that is insulin. Okay, now insulin, remember, they are of two types. One is animal source, one is by recombinant DNA technology known as humulin or human insulin. Now what is the route of insulin injection? Remember, they all are given by subcutaneous injection, but there are certain insulin which are given nasally. So one nasally approved insulin is Afrezza. It's a very short acting insulin. It is given before meals and it is combined with long acting subcutaneous insulin, Afrezza. Okay, then we have IV insulin. IV insulin is given in emergency situation and regular insulin is considered as a drug of choice for IV insulin. Okay, now insulin cannot be given orally. It's a water soluble molecule. It cannot cross blood brain barrier and cannot cross placenta to enter into the fetus, and it cannot be given intradermally also. So these are the various sites of insulin injection. The most common site of insulin injection is abdomen, upper arm, buttocks, thigh anterior and lateral. The fastest absorption of insulin is at abdomen. Insulin is never given in forearm and 2 cm around umbilicus. And repetitive injection of insulin, as it is an anabolic hormone, can lead to hypertrophy of fat out there, which is known as lipodystrophy, and sometimes scarring. Why sometimes scarring? Because of allergic reaction. Okay, and these are the various preparations of insulin: ultra short, short, intermediate and long. Remember, ultra short and short insulin. In ultra short we have lispro, aspart and glucosamine. They all have S word in between. And short we have regular insulin, with other names of regular insulins are written as here. Now remember, ultra short and short insulin, they are given before meals to control postprandial hyperglycemia. While intermediate and long acting insulin, they are given to control the basal level of glucose. Okay. So these are the insulin. The shortest is Lispro. The longest is Degludec. Okay. Then we have a Lente insulin, which is an intermediate acting insulin, which is a mixture of semi-Lente and ultra-Lente in a ratio of 30:70. Okay. Semi-Lente is also known as amorphous. Ultra-Lente is also known as crystalline. Okay. Now, remember, the ultra-short, short and intermediate acting insulin, they are at same pH. They can be mixed with each other. They are known as mixed-charge insulin. While long-acting insulin, they are at different pH. They should not be mixed with above insulin. So they are given always as a separate injection like Detemir, Glargine and Degludec. And Detemir and Glargine, they are also known as acidic insulin. And they are such a long-acting insulin that they are known as peakless insulin as well. They don't have any peak. Okay. Now, what is the use of insulin? Insulin is the drug of choice for various long-term control of diabetes. Insulin is also the drug of choice for diabetic ketoacidosis and hyperosmolar hyperglycemic coma. So this is the management of diabetic ketoacidosis. The mainstay of treatment is always give fluid replacement. Okay, this is the most mainstay. Then assess potassium level. Remember, if there is hypokalemia, don't give insulin because insulin itself causes hypokalemia. So first correct potassium and then give insulin. First we give a bolus of 0.1 international unit per kg and then the same dose is maintained per hour. Remember, never give insulin rapidly. It may lead to hypokalemia and hypoglycemia, which are very dangerous condition. So this is the treatment of hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia is a very dangerous condition. It can lead to cardiac arrhythmias. So first we have to protect the heart by giving calcium gluconate. Then we want to remove this potassium into the tissue by giving insulin in 50% dextrose, or you can add salbutamol also, because salbutamol has two action. It increases insulin level as well as it has direct action. It can make this potassium enter into the muscles. Then we can give sodium bicarbonate to reduce metabolic acidosis which occurs due to hyperkalemia. Then we can also remove this potassium out of the body by diuretic and dialysis. Remember, hemodialysis is the most reliable and most effective way. And in further in long term, we can reduce the absorption of potassium into the blood by giving potassium binders like polystyrene sulfonate, sorbitol and pitidomer. These are the side effects of insulin. That is, hypoglycemia is the most common side effect and it is treated by IV dextrose, oral dextrose, or we can give intramuscular glucagon. Remember, glucagon has two uses. First, it is used to treat hypoglycemia due to insulin. Another use of glucagon is, glucagon is a drug of choice for bradycardia due to beta blockers. It can stimulate heart. Hypokalemia, yes. Weight gain, because it's an anabolic hormone, edema and fluid retention, allergic reaction and lipodystrophy. So this is all about insulin. So let's solve the first question. That is, glucagon is most effective for which of the following condition? Remember, glucagon has two uses. First, it is used for the treatment of hypoglycemia. And second, it is also given as a drug of choice to treat bradycardia due to beta blocker. Bradycardia to beta blockers. The reason is, glucagon, it has direct receptors on heart. The receptors of glucagon on heart is GS type, and glucagon, when stimulate GS type of receptor, it increases cyclic AMP level in the heart and it can increase heart rate. It can directly stimulate heart. Okay, so these are the two uses of glucagon. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see the answer. Glucagon is most effective. The answer for this question is B. If you see B, old man with decreased blood pressure and heart rate due to atenolol. Why? Because atenolol is a beta blocker. Okay. Which insulin is never mixed with other insulin? Whenever this question comes, try to find out the long acting insulin. And among long acting insulin, you know, there is Detemir and Glargine. Okay, remember, long-acting insulin should not be mixed with any other insulin like ultra-short, short and intermediate. Ultra-short, short and intermediate acting insulin, they have same pH, they can be mixed. These insulins should not be mixed, they are acidic insulin. So the answer for your question is Glargine. And Glargine comes with a brand name Lentus. It comes with a brand name Lentus. Insulin release due to potassium closure is seen with. Now let's talk about the other drugs apart from insulin. The other drugs apart from insulin are known as oral hypoglycemic agents. They are also known as anti-hyperglycemic agents. Now, these drugs can be, for our convenience, can be divided into the drugs which are acting on pancreas level or peripheral organ level. Now, the drugs which are acting at pancreas level, they are either acting on beta cells, they promote insulin secretion, they are known as insulin secretagogue. We have sulfonylurea and meglitinides. Sulfonylurea, they are of two generation, we will discuss. Chlorpropamide and gliburide. Then we have meglitinide. All meglitinide, remember, they end with the word glinide. These drugs, why they are known as insulin secretagogue? Because they close potassium channel on beta cells of pancreas, which promote insulin secretion. Then we have a drug, pramlintide, which suppress glucagon production by acting on alpha cells. Then we have a drug which will act on both way. They are known as incretins. Incretins are known as recombinant GLP-1 analog. Remember, these drugs, incretin, they end with the word tide, exenatide, liraglutide. Then incretins, we have a drug known as DPP-4 inhibitor. DPP stands for dipeptidyl peptidase. This enzyme degrades incretin in the body. So we have DPP-4 inhibitor. These drugs are known as gliptins. They will end with the word gliptin. Okay. Then we have a drug which will act on peripheral organs. That is biguanides, metformin. It will act on liver and inhibit hepatic gluconeogenesis. Then we have alpha glucosidase inhibitor, which will reduce the absorption of glucose from intestine. Okay, that is acarbose, voglibose, and miglitol. Then we have thiazolidinedione. They will act on adipose tissue and improve insulin resistance. So these are, they will end with the word glitazone, like pioglitazone, rosiglitazone. Then we have sodium glucose transporter inhibitor. These drugs, they act at a level of kidney and reduce the absorption of glucose. Glucose will be excreted out into the urine. So canagliflozin, dapagliflozin, empagliflozin, etc. They will end with the word gliflozin. Then we have bromocriptine, which reduces the hyperglycemic hormones like prolactin and growth hormone, which generally counteract the effects of insulin. So we suppress the hormones production from anterior pituitary by giving bromocriptine. It's a dopamine agonist. So these are the drugs. And these are the sulfonylurea. Remember, insulin secretagogues, they are divided into two, sulfonylurea and meglitinides. Why? Because they will directly go to the beta cells of pancreas. They will close potassium sensitive ATP's channel, and that closure will lead to insulin release. But remember, they have some extra pancreatic action. They improve insulin sensitivity as well as on long term. They increase receptors of insulin on other organs. So these are the drugs, sulfonylurea, first generation, second generation. First generation, you are seeing, they will end with the word amide. All will end with the word amide. And second generation, they will start with the word gli. Okay, glimepiride, glipizide, gliclazide. Similarly, okay, so keep this thing in mind. So let's make a summary of these drugs. These are the drugs, and this summary we will be discussing shortly, that what is the route of administration, in which type of diabetes we will use, they will affect weight or not, will they cause hypoglycemia or not, and any special point that they are safe in renal failure or hepatic failure. So this summary we will discuss shortly. So let's keep this thing in mind and solve all the questions of diabetes now. So insulin released due to closure of potassium channel is due to sulfonylurea and meglitinides. Okay, these two drugs. And among them, you will find nateglinide. All meglitinide, they will end with the word glinide. That is nateglinide and repaglinide. So the answer out here is nateglinide. Okay, they are known as insulin secretagogues, these two drugs. Long acting insulin. The overall longest acting insulin is degludec. Okay, next is glargine. Glargine act for 24 hours and degludec act for 42 hours. These are the longest acting insulin. Okay, and the shortest acting insulin you will write is lispro. Lispro is the shortest acting insulin. So the answer out here you will find is glargine. Degludec is not given. Okay. Which of the following does not cause hypoglycemia? So if you see the options, which drugs causes hypoglycemia, you will see the first four class of drug, that is insulin, sulfonylurea, meglitinide, and pramlintide, they cause hypoglycemia. Apart from this, No other drugs in diabetes cause hypoglycemia. Okay? So insulin, sulfonylurea, meglitinidin, pramlintide causes hypoglycemia. No other drug will cause hypoglycemia. So insulin, it's absolutely true. It causes hypoglycemia. Glimepiride is a sulfonylurea. Yes, it causes. Glyclazide is also a sulfonylurea. It will cause. So the answer out here will be metformin. Remember, metformin does not cause hypoglycemia. Drug used to control postprandial hyperglycemia. Okay. Now remember, the drugs which are used to control postprandial hyperglycemia is, the first is alpha glucosidase inhibitors. Okay. Second, you will write meglitinides. Third, you will write sulfonylurea, only second generation sulfonylurea. Remember, these drugs, they are used to control postprandial hypoglycemia. So among them, you will find alpha glucosidase inhibitor, it's absolutely true, acarbose. Bigonide contains metformin. The answer is no. Sulfonylurea, it's not mentioned first or second generation, hence we will not write with the answer. Then meglitinide, the answer is repaglinide. It's absolutely true. Okay, so these are the two answers. Which of the following is not an insulin analog? Remember, insulin analog are those drugs which are formed by recombinant DNA technology. And these insulin, remember, are ultra short acting insulin. They are ultra short acting insulin. How to remember their name? They will have S word in between and the mnemonic is LAG, that is Dispro, Aspart, and Glulisine. Lispro, Aspart, and Glulisine. Okay, first point. Second point you will write that glargine insulin, Detemir insulin, and degludec insulin are also formed by recombinant DNA technology. So they are insulin analog. Now the second method of insulin formation is animal insulin. The insulin which are formed from, synthesized from animal. So insulin analogs are those which are formed from recombinant DNA technology. Among them we have three insulin. We will write, those are regular insulin. Remember, regular insulin is also known as ectrapid. Second is NPH and third is Lente. These three insulin, remember, are of animal origin and they are not known as insulin analog. Insulin analog means which are formed from recombinant human DNA technology. So they are just like human insulin. So the answer out here is ectrapid. Ectrapid is another name of regular insulin. Okay. Now, which of the following drug is used to treat type 2 diabetes mellitus causes weight loss? Okay. Now, let's see which of the following drug causes weight loss, which of the following drug causes weight gain. Remember, metformin is a biguanide. Glimepiride is a sulfonylurea. Repaglinide is a meglitinide. Glyclazide is again a sulfonylurea. Now let's see which drug causes weight loss and weight gain. If you see, insulin is an anabolic hormone, it causes weight gain, first class. Second is sulfonylurea. Remember, sulfonylurea and meglitinides, they cause insulin release and they also cause anabolism and weight gain. So the first three drugs, they cause weight gain. And the last drug you will see is thiazolidinediones. So these are the four classes of drugs which causes weight gain. Okay, rest apart from this, all other drugs are either caused, they will cause weight loss or weight neutral drugs. Okay, so the drugs which causes weight loss are pramlintide, recombinant GLP-1 analog, incretins, liraglutide, even approved as an anti-inflammatory drug, and SGLT2 inhibitors also causes weight loss. Metformin causes weight loss in obese, neutral in thin individual. Okay, so remember, the drugs which causes weight gain are insulin, sulfonylurea, meglitinides, and thiazolidinedione, like pioglitazone, rosiglitazone. Okay, and among them, the answer is metformin. Metformin causes weight loss. Somatostatin is secreted by which cells of pancreas? Remember, in pancreas, we have three cells, alpha cells, beta cells, and delta cells. Alpha cells in pancreas secretes glucagon. Beta cells in pancreas secretes insulin. It also secretes C-peptide. And it also secretes amylin. Three things. Delta cells, remember, secretes an inhibitory hormone, somatostatin. So these are the three types of cells of endocrine pancreas. So the answer out here is delta cells. Okay. All of the following drugs are used in the management of diabetes mellitus causes hypoglycemia except. So remember, first four drug, they cause hypoglycemia except metformin. Tolbutamide and all these three drugs are sulfonylurea. Remember, sulfonylurea causes hypoglycemia. Most important step in management of diabetic ketoacidosis is to give fluid replacement. We have already seen the management of diabetic ketoacidosis. So this was the management. Let's come back. The most critical and the most important step is to give fluid replacement to prevent this dehydration. Okay. Then we assess potassium. After assessing potassium, we give insulin. Okay. And insulin should be given slowly, not rapidly. But we give, if you will give rapid insulin injection, it will lead to hypoglycemia, hypokalemia. So the most important step in management is intravenous fluid or saline. Okay. Now sulfonylurea, they act by. Now we know that sulfonylurea is an insulin secretagogue. It releases insulin directly from the beta cell of pancreas by closing potassium channel. So it stimulates beta cell of pancreas to release insulin. Death from lactic acidosis in diabetes mellitus is associated with therapy of. Remember, lactic acidosis is a characteristic side effect of biguanides. Okay, biguanides contains metformin and fenformin. Okay, now fenformin got banned. Fenformin got banned because of death due to lactic acidosis. Okay, death due to lactic acidosis. One basic question arises, sir, why do they cause lactic acidosis? Remember, biguanides, what is their mechanism of action? Biguanides, they inhibit, they stimulate one enzyme in liver known as AMPK enzyme. Now what will happen when AMPK enzyme is stimulated? It inhibit hepatic gluconeogenesis. Hepatic gluconeogenesis means that glucose will not be formed from other sources like lactic acid. Lactic acid can convert it into glucose. This is known as hepatic gluconeogenesis. Remember, these drugs, they inhibit hepatic gluconeogenesis. Hence, the level of lactic acid increases. Now, the point is, this fenformin got banned because it was very long acting drug and the level of lactic acid was increased in a very high proportion. But remember, metformin is an approved drug. Fenformin got banned. Hence, the answer for this question comes out to be fenformin, not metformin. Okay? Because it was leading to deaths. The following insulin can be given intravenously. Remember, if the word intravenous insulin comes, blindly mark the answer as regular insulin. That is an intermediate acting insulin. But remember, you can also give ultra short acting insulin also as intravenous insulin. But traditionally, the drug of choice is regular insulin. Hence, the answer for this question, IV insulin, blindly mark the answer, regular insulin. The long-term use of which anti-diabetic drug leads to B12 deficiency? Remember, B12 deficiency can lead to megaloblastic anemia. Okay, it can lead to megaloblastic anemia due to B12 deficiency is a classical and the characteristic side effect of metformin. It's a characteristic side effect of metformin. So try to remember megaloblastic anemia, metformin. Okay. So the answer for this question comes out to be metformin. Now, which of the following drug does not act by increasing insulin secretion? Exenatide, It's absolutely true. It increases insulin secretion. It was a TIDE. It's a recombinant GLP-1 analog. Okay, we have already written gliptins. It's true. Okay, gliptins is true. It is a DPP-4 inhibitor. Okay, repaglinide, true. It's a meglitinide. It closes potassium channel. The answer is rosiglitazone. Remember, rosiglitazone is a thiazolidine dione. It acts on adipose tissue and reduces insulin level. Okay, which of the following drug does not cause hypoglycemia? The answer out here is acarbose. Insulin, yes. Sulfonylurea, true. Meglitinides, true. We have discussed. The answer is acarbose. True about pioglitazone. Now remember, pioglitazone is a class of drug known as thiazolidine dione. Now these drugs, remember, they are PPAR gamma agonist. PPAR is a type of nuclear receptor which is located on gene. They will go to the cell of this adipose tissue and they will stimulate this PPAR gamma agonist, and it will try to produce insulin responsive proteins. This adipose tissue will produce insulin responsive proteins. Now these insulin responsive protein, in the presence of insulin, they will function. Like on adipose tissue, there is one insulin responsive protein known as GLUT4. So the glucose will enter from the blood into adipose tissue. Similarly, it will also increase the action of adiponectin. Okay, so this is their action. So they will increase the activity of adipose tissue. So the answer for this question is, all these thiazolidine dione, remember, they will end with the word glitazone. So we had three drugs. The first drug which we made was troglitazone. But remember, this troglitazone got banned because it was hepatotoxic. Then we made rosiglitazone. Remember, rosiglitazone is also banned in India because it was causing MI and heart failure. So lastly, we made pioglitazone. But sometime before, pioglitazone also got banned because of the risk of urinary bladder cancer. But now it is an approved drug, again came back into the market because it is one of the safe drug in renal failure. All these drugs, remember, they are given orally and they are metabolized by CYP3A4 enzyme. And these drugs are safe in renal failure. That is the main advantage. But they should not be given in hepatic failure. So keeping this thing in mind, let's talk about pioglitazone. So pioglitazone, it is metabolized by CYP3A4. Yes, many drugs, they get metabolized by CYP3A4. It is a selective agonist of PPAR gamma receptor. It's absolutely true. It is active. It is a PPAR gamma agonist. It causes transcription of gene of carbohydrate and fat metabolism in the absence of insulin. The answer is no. It will only do in the presence of insulin. So it's a false statement. Okay, so which is the false statement? It is not in the absence of insulin, it is always in the presence of insulin. It should be avoided in the patient of cardiovascular disease. It's absolutely true. That is why rosiglitazone got banned. Okay, it should be avoided in the patients of cardiovascular disease. So keep this thing in mind. So for the complete details, you can see the videos. All of the following statements about nitaglinide are true except nitaglinide, remember, is a meglitinide. It goes to the beta cells of pancreas, it opens closes potassium channel, and it will directly release insulin from beta cells of pancreas. Okay, it's a very short acting drug. It is given for control of postprandial hyperglycemia. It's absolutely true. We have already discussed. Hypoglycemia is less common with sulfonylurea. True, because it's a short acting drug. Sulfonylurea is a very long acting drug. They will cause prolonged hypoglycemia. It can decrease insulin resistance. The answer is false. Okay, it act by increasing insulin release. It's absolutely true. Okay, so the false statement is this. But I want to tell you one thing, that in general, if you go very deeply into this concept, yes, they may decrease insulin. Yes, they may decrease resistance to insulin. But we have to choose a best statement. Hence, we will go by the answer C. It decreases insulin resistance. But remember, sulfonylurea and meglitinide in long term can reduce insulin resistance. Okay. What will happen if insulin is given rapidly in diabetic ketoacidosis? If you will give rapidly, it will lead to hypokalemia and hypoglycemia. Okay. So insulin, remember, causes hypoglycemia as well as hypokalemia. That is why insulin is used in the treatment of hyperglycemia and hyperkalemia. All of the following preparations of insulins are rapid and short acting except. So the answer for this question is glargine. Lispro, aspart, glulisine. Remember, S word is coming. S means short acting. Glargine is a long acting insulin. All of the following statements about alpha-glucosidase inhibitors are true, except they reduce intestinal absorption of carbohydrates. It's absolutely true. Remember, they inhibit an enzyme present on brush border epithelial cells of intestine known as alpha-glucosidase. This alpha-glucosidase is responsible for conversion of complex carbohydrate into small carbohydrate like glucose. Only glucose can be absorbed. They are effective in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. The answer is true. A carbose has been approved for both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. Hypoglycemia is common side effect. Remember, they will not cause hypoglycemia. No. The reason is they are reducing the absorption of glucose. Okay. Only first four drugs I told you were causing hypoglycemia. They can be used with, yes, they are very commonly combined with other hypoglycemic agents. Okay. So, all of the following are true about metformin except. Metformin causes little or no hypoglycemia in non-diabetic patient. The answer is absolutely true. Okay, it will not cause hypoglycemia. It acts by increasing insulin secretion. It's absolutely false. Remember, metformin reduces peripheral resistance of insulin. It cannot act on, metformin does not act on beta cell. It has no action on beta cell. We have already discussed. Okay. It increases peripheral utilization of glucose. Yes. When given with alcohol, it increases the risk of lactic acidosis. The answer is yes, because alcohol can also form lactic acid. Anti-diabetic drugs that can be given safely in renal failure are. Remember, the drug of choice among diabetes and renal failure is insulin. But if you talk about oral hypoglycemic agent, the safest drug, safest means even if the GFR is less than 15 ml per minute, the safest drug is, you will write, first is linagliptin. Second you will write is dulaglutide. And third you will write is pioglitazone, and the brother of pioglitazone, that is rosiglitazone. Okay, pioglitazone and rosiglitazone. Now the next point is the drug which are safer, which will require lower dose. Lower dose means that they can be given in 15 to 30 ml per minute of GFR, but in less dose. The answer you will write is meglitinides. Meglitinides like repaglinide and natiglinide. And you can also give second generation sulfonylurea like glipizide and glyclazide. Okay. And remember, till here, metformin is absolutely contraindicated. Metformin should be given even only if the GFR is more than 45 ml per minute. Only then metformin is prescribed. Remember, metformin is absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. So if somebody will ask you the drug of choice in renal failure, you have to see the list from out here. The safest drug: linagliptin, dulaglutide, pioglitazone and rosiglitazone. Okay, so among them, the only answer you will get out here is rosiglitazone. Okay, the only answer out here is rosiglitazone. Which of the following drug releases endogenous insulin? The answer is sulfonylurea. Try to find a sulfonylurea. That is glipizide. Okay. glipizide. Which of the following anti-diabetic drug B12 deficiency? The answer is metformin. A patient receiving insulin and acarbose for diabetes mellitus develop hypoglycemia. Which of the following should be used in the treatment of hypoglycemia? Now remember, acarbose is an alpha-glucosidase inhibitor. It inhibits alpha-glucosidase enzyme. Now remember, the function of alpha-glucosidase is to convert complex carbohydrate like disaccharide into monosaccharide. This is the function of alpha-glucosidase enzyme, which is located on the brush border epithelial cells of intestine. Example of one disaccharide is sucrose, which is known as table sugar, which we eat normally in our, and it will be converted into glucose and fructose, which are monosaccharide. Remember, only glucose and only monosaccharides can come into the blood, which can be absorbed. Remember, disaccharide cannot be absorbed. Hence, the function of this enzyme is to convert disaccharide into monosaccharide. What is acarbose? Acarbose inhibit this enzyme located on the intestine. Hence, sucrose will not be converted into monosaccharides. So now the point is, if a patient taking insulin, acarbose itself will not cause hypoglycemia. But remember, if hypoglycemia develops due to insulin, and when a patient develops hypoglycemia, most commonly the patient will rush into the kitchen and try to eat table sugar or sucrose. Remember, if the patient is on acarbose, table sugar will not be converted into glucose and fructose, and these monosaccharides will not be absorbed. Hence, remember, sucrose, which is a disaccharide made up of glucose plus fructose, galactose, again a disaccharide made up of glucose plus lactose, starch, which is also a polymer of glucose, will not be broken down by alpha glucosidase because acarbose has inhibited them. So the answer is, give pure glucose in this patient. So if a patient develops hypoglycemia, give pure glucose or pure fructose, because acarbose will not allow the conversion of complex carbohydrate into monosaccharides. All of the following statements about exenatide is true, except exenatide. Remember, it's a recombinant GLP-1 analog. And remember, it is given right now, it has been approved for type 2 diabetes only. We have discussed. And remember, all recombinant GLP analog, if you see the list which we have written, recombinant GLP-1 analog, remember, they are only given by subcutaneous injection. They are given only in type 2 diabetes. They cause weight loss. They do not cause hypoglycemia, and they will end with the word TIDE, like liraglutide, etc. So keep this thing in mind. The answer out here is, it's absolutely true. It is given for the treatment of type 1 diabetes. It's absolutely false statement. Only two. Given subcutaneously is true. It decreases glucagon secretion. Make it glucagon. It reduces glucagon secretion. It's absolutely true. We know they decrease glucagon and they increase insulin secretion. We have already seen in their mechanism of action. Okay. Now, insulin causes all of the following except, remember, insulin is an anabolic hormone. So think about anabolism now. It causes glycogenesis. Yes, something is synthesizing. True. It will cause glycolysis. Yes, glycolysis will promote fat deposition. Lipogenesis. True. Ketones are formed through the breakdown of fat. The answer is false. Ketogenesis. Remember, ketogenesis is a catabolic product. It's not due to anabolism. So this was the action of insulin, which we have already discussed. Okay. So insulin prevents everything. So insulin, remember, inhibit glycogen breakdown. Insulin inhibit gluconeogenesis. Insulin inhibit lipolysis and insulin inhibit ketone formation. So the answer is, it inhibits ketogenesis. Okay. Which of the following statement regarding acarbose is false? It acts by inhibiting alpha-glucosidase, absolutely true. It reduces postprandial hyperglycemia, it's absolutely true. It is given before meals. It decreases progression of impaired glucose tolerance to overt diabetes. It's absolutely true. It causes hypoglycemia. False. I told you that only first four drugs, that is insulin, sulfonylurea, meglitinides and pramlintide, causes hypoglycemia. No other drug causes hypoglycemia. Okay, so let's see again that chart which we have made. Okay, let's see the chart. So the hypoglycemia is caused by first four drug, and if you'll see metformin, alpha glucosidase and thiazolidine dione, apart from type 2 diabetes, they are also given in impaired glucose tolerance, IGT. IGT stands for impaired glucose tolerance. Alpha glucosidase inhibitor like acarbose do not cause hypoglycemia. They are weight neutral drugs. They are given orally and they are given to control postprandial hyperglycemia. So see this word in green. This is the use of acarbose alpha glucosidase inhibitors. Now, which of the following statement about biguanides is not true? That is false. Remember, in biguanides you have metformin and fenformin. Okay. They stimulate insulin. They do not stimulate insulin release. It's absolutely true. They cannot release insulin. They decrease hepatic glucose production. Yes, they inhibit hepatic gluconeogenesis. Renal dysfunction is not a contraindication. It's absolutely false. We have already discussed that metformin is absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. Okay. And lastly, it can be combined with sulfonylurea. Yes, anti-diabetic agents, they are very usually combined among themselves. If a patient, diabetic patient being treated with oral hypoglycemic agent develops dilutional hyponatremia, which of the following is cont? Remember, dilutional hyponatremia occurs due to increase in ADH level, antidiuretic level. This condition is also known as SIADH. The only anti-diabetic agent which can cause SIADH is chlorpropamide. And chlorpropamide is a type of sulfonylurea which has been banned now. Okay, so the answer out here is chlorpropamide. It is the only sulfonylurea. Remember, rest are also sulfonylurea, but chlorpropamide only. So just write the side effects of chlorpropamide. Remember, chlorpropamide causes cholestatic jaundice. It causes SIADH, which can lead to dilutional hyponatremia. It can lead to agranulocytosis, decrease in neutrophil, and aplastic anemia. And lastly, it also causes disulfiram-like reaction. Disulfiram-like reaction, if a drug shows, remember, these drugs should not be given in chronic alcoholics. So these are the side effects of chlorpropamide, which is very important for you. You must remember. Now, true about Lispro. Now, Lispro is the overall shortest acting insulin. We know, yes, it's absolutely true that action is faster and shorter. It's absolutely true. It's given 15 minutes prior to meal. Yes. The source is lamb. The answer is false. It is not from any animal. Remember, it is synthesized from recombinant DNA technology. Okay. Action is faster and longer than regular insulin. Again, it's a false statement. Okay. So remember, the true answer is A and B. Okay. Its action is faster and shorter than regular insulin. It is given 15 minutes prior to meal to control postprandial hyperglycemia. A and B are the correct answer. Okay. Now let's come to the next question. The most likely complication of insulin therapy in ketoacidosis is hypoglycemia. It's very simple and logical answer. Which of the following drug is taken during the first part of the meal in the purpose of delaying absorption of dietary carbohydrate, to try to think which drug was acting at a level of intestine and reducing the absorption of glucose? That was alpha glucosidase inhibitor. The answer for this question is acarbose. Okay. Which of the following patient is most likely to be treated with intravenous glucagon? So we discussed that glucagon had two uses. One was for the treatment of hypoglycemia. And second, glucagon was a drug of choice for beta blocker toxicity. So these are the two uses of glucagon. Try to find the answer. The answer for this question is B. सी, एन ओल्ड एज मैन विथ सीवियर ब्रेडिकार्डियन हाइपोटेंशन ड्यू टू एटीनोलॉल. रिमेंबर एटीनोलॉल इज अ बीटा ब्लॉकर. ह्यूमन इंसुलिन एज कंपेयर टू पॉर्क एंड बीफ इंसुलिन, रिमेंबर इज रैपिडली एब्सॉर्ब्ड. ओके, इट्स रैपिडली एब्सॉर्ब्ड. सो रिमेंबर दिस पार्ट, इट्स रैपिडली एब्सॉर्ब्ड. नाउ लेट्स मूव फॉरवर्ड. Glibenclamide, it's a sulfonylurea starting with the word gli, reduces blood glucose level in following. Remember, sulfonylurea, they go to the beta cells of pancreas and they close the outward movement of potassium. They close ATP sensitive potassium channel. So the positive charge inside the cell increases, positive charge, which will lead to depolarization of cell and insulin is released. So can we say that sulfonylurea require normal beta cells for their functioning? So the point is, remember, in type 1 diabetes, there is no beta cell. There is beta cell destruction. The beta cells get destroyed in type 1 diabetes. So remember, sulfonylurea are not effective in type 1 diabetes. Okay? So it is not effective in type 1 diabetes because there is no beta cell from where it can release insulin. Metformin is not effective in lowering blood sugar in which of the following patient? The answer for this question is non-diabetics. Remember, metformin has no effect in non-diabetic because in non-diabetic, the insulin resistance, insulin sensitivity is normal. What is the action of metformin? Metformin decreases insulin resistance or increase insulin sensitivity. Hence, if the insulin sensitivity will increase, the blood glucose will enter into the muscles and fats. This is the function of metformin. But remember, in non-diabetic patient, the insulin sensitivity is normal. Okay? The correct statement regarding the present status of oral hypoglycemic agents in diabetic patients is, it is the first drug of choice in all of the following cases? False. Remember, the first drug of choice in type 1 diabetes and gestational diabetes is insulin, not oral hypoglycemic agent. They should be prescribed only if the patient refuses insulin injection. It's absolutely false. Remember, insulin is mandatory in type 1 diabetes. Okay? They are used in type 1 diabetes. All of the following? False. Only two oral hypoglycemic agents are given in type 1 diabetes. They are mainly given for type 2 diabetes. Okay? They are used first in most cases of uncomplicated mild to moderate type 2 diabetes. The answer is absolutely true. As we have already seen the management of type 2 diabetes, we started with metformin. A 15-year-old girl with type 1 diabetes is brought to emergency complaining of dizziness. Laboratory finding shows hyperglycemia, ketoacidosis. So it's a clear-cut case of diabetic ketoacidosis, and the blood pH is acidic. So hence, ketones body can turn the blood pH into acidic. Okay. Now, to achieve rapid control of ketoacidosis, the best drug is, remember, it's an emergency situation. In emergency situation, we give IV insulin. And the drug of choice as an IV insulin, we have already discussed, is regular insulin. So go by the answer, regular insulin is the drug of choice. Now remember, regular insulin has other names, like it is also known as ectrapid insulin. It is also known as zinc crystalline insulin. It is also known as hexamer insulin, insulin hexamer. Okay. So try to find one of these words. The answer is crystalline zinc insulin, which is another name of regular insulin. Now insulin causes potassium entry into the cell. Remember, it's a kind of anabolic effect of insulin. Okay? That is why insulin is used in the treatment of hyperkalemia in blood, because it may move potassium into muscles and fats. Okay? It's a kind of anabolic. Now, sulfonylurea, remember, they increase insulin from beta cells of pancreas. Hence, the answer is D. They increase insulin from beta cells of pancreas. Now, the next question is, adverse effect of insulin includes all of the following. The answer is hyperglycemia. We know that insulin causes hypoglycemia. Okay, edema, it's absolutely true. Lipodystrophy, allergy. So I'll just show you the side effect of insulin again. Okay, so these are the side effect of insulin. The most common dose related and preventable causes hypoglycemia. It causes hypokalemia, weight gain, edema, allergic reaction and lipodystrophy at the site of subcutaneous injection. Now, second generation sulfonylurea are all except, remember, all second generation sulfonylurea, they will start with the word GLE. So the answer out here is tolbutamide. Tolbutamide is rather first generation. They will end with the word amide. Okay. Which of the following drug is an alpha glucosidase inhibitor? I told you, acarbose, voglibose and meglitol. These are the three drugs. The answer out here is meglitol. Insulin having longest duration of action. We have discussed degludec followed by glargine. Degludec is a new drug. Degludec 42 hours, glargine 24 hours. So the answer out here you will write among them is not written. That is, these are long acting insulin. Okay. So although this is not written, now let's see what should be the answer. So let's come to the insulin, various insulin according to their duration of action. So the shortest acting is lispro-aspartate and glulisine. They are sometimes known as monocomponent insulin. Longer than ultra short is short acting insulin, regular, which is also known as ectrapid, crystalline, soluble and hexamer. Intermediate known as neutral protamine H-DON NPH. It is also known as isophane insulin. Then we have Detemir, glargine and degludec. Overall longest acting is degludec followed by glargine. Then we have Lente insulin, which is a component of Ultralente and Semilente. Now, keeping this thing in mind, our question was asking which of the following is the longest acting. And in longest acting, remember, an option is given, protamine insulin. Now, remember, protamine is given and it is an intermediate acting insulin. Other options which are given is insulin zinc suspension, that is Lente. Then it is given insulin, plain insulin, which is sometimes known as your short acting insulin. So the answer for this question comes out to be your protamine insulin, that is NPH. NPH is an intermediate acting insulin. Among intermediate acting insulin, NPH followed by Lente. Okay, so this is the answer. Now, oral hypoglycemic agent, protamine insulin is also known as NPH insulin. Lente is also known as insulin zinc suspension. Now, oral hypoglycemic drug that is less likely to cause hypoglycemia. Now, we know that sulfonylurea, insulin and meglitol meglitinides like repaglinide, nitaglinide, they cause hypoglycemia. Meglitinide, yes, it causes. Glyclazide, sulfonylurea, yes, causes. Glimepiride, sulfonylurea, yes, causes. The answer is rosiglitazone, which is a thiazolidine dione. Common side effect of thiazolidine dione is, now thiazolidine dione, the drugs are rosiglitazone, pioglitazone, etc. Let's talk about their side effect. These drugs, remember, they cause anemia, they cause osteoporosis, and which may increase the risk of fractures. And remember, they have anti-diuretic action. They cause sodium and water retention. Now, due to sodium and water retention, the plasma volume will increase. Because of this reason, they are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure, especially NYHA 3 and 4 heart failure. Okay, and especially of diastolic variety. Diastolic heart failure. Okay, and lastly, they cause weight gain. Okay, so these are the side effects of thiazolidine dions. Go by the answer this. Okay, and anemia. These are the two answers of thiazolidine dion. But if somebody will ask you, even more common is weight gain. It is even more common than anemia. Insulin acts by stimulation of, now remember, the receptors of insulin, any anabolic hormone, The receptors of insulin is enzyme-linked receptor. Enzyme-linked receptor, remember, in case of insulin, is also known as tyrosine kinase receptor. Because these tyrosine kinase or enzyme-linked receptor, they are responsible for cell division. That is why these receptors, they are acted upon by anabolic hormone. The answer is enzymatic receptor. Specifically, it is tyrosine kinase receptors. Okay. Which of the following characteristics make metformin a preferred biguanide than fenformin? Remember, fenformin was a long-acting drug. It got banned because of death due to lactic acidosis. It was a long-acting drug. It got banned because of the death, cases of death due to lactic acidosis. Metformin is a short-acting drug. Very rarely it will cause lactic acidosis. So, why metformin is a better drug? Because it is less liable to cause lactic acidosis. So, this is the answer. The risk of lactic acidosis with metformin is very less. Fenformin, it was very high and fenformin got banned. Now, glibenclamide is a sulfonylurea, a second generation sulfonylurea, preferred over chlorpropamide. Chlorpropamide is first generation sulfonylurea. Then why? Because it is less likely to cause hypoglycemia. The answer is yes. First generation, they are short acting drug. Sorry, second generation, they are short acting drug. They are less likely to talk hypoglycemia. Now, chlorpropamide, we have already discussed, it causes disulfiram-like reaction and cholestatic jaundice. So, the answer is all of the above. Because of disulfiram-like reaction, it should not be given in an alcoholic patient. It can lead to intolerance and various side effects. The answer for this question is all of the above. So, I'll just show you the slide of sulfonylurea, the difference between sulfonylurea. Okay. So, this is the difference between sulfonylurea. Okay, the first generation are long-acting and less potent. They reduce basal as well as postprandial glucose level. They have more risk of hypoglycemia as compared to second generation. Okay, so they have more risk. So, chlorpropamide is a first generation. Glibenclamide is a second generation. Now, let's come to question 53. Which of the following statement about nitaglenide is true? Nitaglenide is a meglitinide. So, they have same action like sulfonylurea. Okay. It's a long-acting hypoglycemic agent. It's absolutely false. Remember, it's a very short-acting drug. It is given just to control postprandial hyperglycemia. Why? It is given just before meals. So, it is taken just before meals. It limits postprandial hyperglycemia. It's absolutely true. It lowers blood glucose level in type 1 and type 2. It's absolutely false statement. Remember, meglitinides, they are not given in. They are only given in type 2 diabetes because they require beta cell for release of insulin. In type 1 diabetes, remember, they are not used. In type 1 diabetes, there is no beta cell. In type 1 diabetes, only 3 drugs were approved, we have discussed. They act by opening potassium channel. The answer is absolutely false. The answer is absolutely false. It rather close potassium channel. It rather close potassium channel. So, the only true statement now you are finding is it is taken just before meals. Is B answer. Which of the following drug is most likely to cause hypoglycemia when used as a monotherapy for type 2 diabetes? The answer is glipizide. Glipizide is a sulfonylurea. A 54-year-old obese patient with type 2 diabetes with a history of alcoholism that probably should not release metformin. Remember, metformin causes lactic acidosis. And alcohol also causes lactic acidosis. And lactic acidosis is a dangerous condition. Okay. Which of the following is not used for the treatment of insulin-induced hypoglycemia? The answer is adrenaline. Okay. So, we have discussed, we give glucose and glucagon. Okay. So, adrenaline is an incorrect. There is no role of adrenaline. Okay. Now, flushing is a common side effect of a patient taking oral hypoglycemic drug with alcohol. Remember, flushing with alcohol is a classical case of disulfiram-like reaction. And you know which drug causes disulfiram-like reaction? That was chlorpropamide. Lactic acidosis is common with metformin and fenformin. Okay, but if a question will ask you, choose among them. If one option is asked, then you will mark the answer as fenformin, because fenformin got banned because of lactic acidosis only. Long-acting insulin is, the answer among this question is ultralente. Okay, ultralente is long-acting, lente is intermediate, lente is intermediate, semilente is short, lispro is ultra short. Ultralente is long-acting insulin. Monocomponent insulin, remember, was ultra short-acting insulin. Okay, and there were three: lispro, aspart, and glulisine lag. Okay, so why they are preferred? Because they are very short-acting drug. If insulin is very short-acting drug, remember, it will have less chance of hypoglycemia. So it can be used in pregnancy. True, insulin are the drug of choice in pregnancy. They cause less hypoglycemia. The answer is yes. Longer duration of action. This is a false statement. Less chance of lipodystrophy. True, because monocomponent insulin, they are rapidly absorbed from subcutaneous sites. They don't tend to deposit particularly at that subcutaneous site. They rapidly come into the blood. Hence, they will have less chance of fat growth at that local area. So they will have less chance of lipodystrophy. Monotherapy with which of the following anti-diabetic agent can lead to hypoglycemia? The answer is glibenclamide is a sulfonylurea. Metformin and pioglitazone do not cause hypoglycemia. Which of the following is not a starting criteria for sulfonylurea therapy? Total pancreatectomy? No, it cannot be given in total pancreatectomy, because sulfonylurea, they require beta cells to release insulin. Non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, type 2 diabetes? The answer is yes, it can be given in this condition. Diabetes after 60 years? True, yes, we can give. So the answer which is not a criteria is total pancreatectomy. Remember, sulfonylurea, they are contraindicated in type 1 diabetes. They are contraindicated in pancreatectomy patient because there are no beta cells. Sulfonylurea, they go to the beta cell and release insulin. In these two conditions, no beta cell is present. All of the following are true regarding chlorpropamide. It's a short acting, it's absolutely false. It's a first generation sulfonylurea, and it is overall the longest acting sulfonylurea we have. It causes hypoglycemia in elderly. True, it causes hypoglycemia in everyone. It causes weight gain. It's absolutely true. It causes alcoholic flush. Yes, it causes disulfiram-like reaction. So the answer is short acting. Long acting insulin preparations are frequently administered by subcutaneous route. Okay, no other route. Drug of choice for polycystic ovarian disease is, remember, the drug of choice for PCOD is to start with OCPs. OCPs are considered as a drug of choice for, that is, oral combined contraceptive pill that contains estrogen as well as progesterone. The answer out here is OCP, because OCPs are the drug of choice for PCOD. But we can also add metformin. Now, what is the role of metformin? Remember, metformin decreases insulin resistance, which is associated with PCOD. Metformin can also regularize menses. It has effect. You can also give clomiphene. Clomiphene is given to induce ovulation, because in PCOD, there is an ovulatory infertility. Third, you can give, for the treatment of hirsutism, you can give anti-androgens. You can give anti-androgens like spironolactones, flutamide, ciproterone, etc. Spironolactone, ciproterone, etc. for hirsutism. But remember, the first drug which can take care of all the symptoms of PCOD is OCPs, oral contraceptive pills. Which of the following is not administered by intradermal? Now remember, intradermally we give allergenic testing, and we also test sensitivity testing. We also test the immunity testing, like Monto test and Leptomeric test. All these allergenic and immunity status testing is done by intradermal route because a very small amount of drug is delivered through intradermal. So BCG vaccine is given by intradermal, it's absolutely true. Insulin is never given intradermally. Insulin is rather given as a subcutaneous injection. Monto test, true. Drug sensitivity, true. Hypoglycemia is caused by. The answer is diazoxide. The answer for this question is hypoglycemia is caused by. The answer for this question is alcohol intoxication. Yes, it may cause hypoglycemia. Thiazides, remember, it causes hyperglycemia. Diazoxide also causes hyperglycemia. Metoclopramide is more of a neutral drug. So excessive alcohol intoxication may lead to hypoglycemia. Because of loss of stores of, there is depletion of stores of glycogen in the liver. Okay. Exenatide. Tide word is coming. So remember, recombinant GLP-1 analog. And it is approved for the treatment of diabetes mellitus. Okay. This exenatide has been obtained from the saliva of Gila monster. Gila monster is a type of poisonous lizard from where we have obtained this exenatide. It is given by subcutaneous injection and for the treatment of type 2 diabetes. The main side effect of recombinant GLP analog is it causes pancreatitis. It causes hemorrhagic pancreatitis and it may increase the risk of cancers like pancreatic and thyroidal cancers. Now all of the following act through nuclear receptors except thyroxine, absolutely true. Rosiglitazone, true. Prednisolone, false. Estrogen, true. So the answer is prednisolone. Remember, prednisolone acts by intracytoplasmic receptor. It's a glucocorticoid. So the drugs which act from intranuclear receptor are, you will write a mnemonic tape. That is thyroid hormone, T3 and T4. A for vitamin A. PPAR receptor and PPAR gamma agonist is rosiglitazone, estrogen. And the hormones which act or the drugs which act from intracytoplasmic receptor, you will write glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid. Glucocorticoid we have written prednisolone, mineralocorticoid aldosterone, testosterone, progesterone. So can we say all six steroidal hormone except estrogen, they act from intracytoplasmic receptor? Lastly, vitamin D3 or calcitriol. Okay. The drug which only reduces postprandial hyperglycemia is, the answer out here is guar gum. Guar gum is a natural product. Okay. It's a plant product which is given. Remember, metformin, troglitazone, pioglitazone, all these drugs, they are not given for postprandial hyperglycemia. So let's see certain natural products in diabetes. So these are the certain natural compounds in diabetes, that is resveratrol. It is obtained from black grapes. Guar gum, it's an indigestible fiber. It has a laxative effect. It reduces postprandial hyperglycemia as well as cholesterol level. So guar gum is the answer. Reduces postprandial hyperglycemia. The main advantage of human insulin is, what do you think? If you obtain insulin from other animals, other animal insulin could be allergic for us. So that is why we develop human insulin, because it can be given to allergic patient. Now biguanides act by. Remember, biguanide contain metformin, and we have discussed metformin act on liver, stimulate AMPK enzyme, adenosine monophosphate kinase, and it inhibit hepatic gluconeogenesis. Okay, hepatic gluconeogenesis, the blood glucose level reduces. As the blood glucose level reduces, the cells which require glucose, the receptors on GLUT receptors on them, GLUT4 receptors on them gradually increases because of less glucose in the blood. Hence, the insulin sensitivity also improves because insulin opens GLUT4 receptors. Okay. So the answer for this question is biguanides, they act by. They increase glycolysis, yes, because more glucose will enter into the cell, true. It inhibits gluconeogenesis, true. It decreases the binding of insulin to its receptors. it decreases the binding of insulin to its receptor? The answer is it rather increases insulin binding to its receptor. Okay, so it's a false statement. And increase insulin from the release of pancreas, again false. Remember, it has no action on insulin. So the answer out here is A and D. Answer out here is A and D. Now, which of the following anti-diabetic agent act as a PPAR gamma agonist? Remember, PPAR gamma agonist drugs are thiazolidine diones. These drugs are known as thiazolidine diones. And remember, these drugs, they will end with the word glitazone. We have already discussed. The answer out here is thiazolidine diones, pioglitazone, rosiglitazone. Mechanism of action of sulfonylurea. Remember, sulfonylurea, they increase insulin synthesis, false. They increase number of insulin receptors. The answer is false. Their main action is to release insulin from the beta cells, but they have certain extra pancreatic action. They can increase sensitivity to the insulin to its receptor. So I'll just show you the action of sulfonylurea. So if you talk about sulfonylurea, their main mechanism of action is to release insulin from the beta cells of pancreas. Okay. So this is the slide which you must remember. So they directly close ATP sensitive potassium channel, release beta cells. But remember, in long term, sulfonylurea, they have extra pancreatic action as well. They improve sensitivity of insulin. They increase sensitivity of insulin to its receptors. Okay. So the answer is B. Now, 75 amino acid sequence of insulin differ from porcine. Sorry, the question is, the amino acid sequence of insulin differs from porcine is. Now remember, if you talk about human insulin, remember, it's a 51 amino acid containing polypeptide. Now it differs from beef and pork insulin, because beef and pork insulin we use in human, they are animal source. Remember, beef insulin and human insulin, they differ in three amino acid sequence. Beef and human insulin, they differ in three amino acid sequence. Pork and human insulin, they differ in one amino acid sequence. That is why pork insulin is more similar to human insulin. So the answer out here is one amino acid. Okay. So the answer out here is one amino acid. So this is all about diabetes mellitus. Okay.